Hey, what's up guys? Welcome back to the channel. My name is Travis and welcome back to another video. So today we are going to be here in the office doing a little bit of a Q&A, subscriber question, address one of the questions slash comments in the comment section. And we're going to do some video overlay because my face is a little messed up from fighting last week. So, you know, I'll spare you guys the expense. But with that, today we are going to talk about a question from Batman. He says, I have cyano slash diatoms and I have zero phosphates and zero nitrates. So I'm assuming it's a question kind of like why you're having it. So we're going to dive into that today. And the reason why I picked this one is because it's all too common to see you guys coming to me because I do the dyno identification all the time and I do the one-on-one Skype calls. And it is extremely common that you guys are coming to me with zero nitrates, zero phosphates, that you guys end up having dyno, cyano issues. And it's just a mess that a lot of us are running into. And if we were to kind of like step back 5 or 6 years ago, it really wasn't something that we worried about because everybody was striving for zero nitrates and phosphates because Zeovit was a thing and everybody was all about it. But now that our equipment has advanced to the point, you know, with, you know, with macroalgae and all these high-end skimmers and the way we do our maintenance and all that stuff, filter socks, rollers, all that good stuff, we're actually stripping the tank of nutrients, maybe, you know, just a little too much than we probably should. Now, with that, when it comes to zero nitrates and zero phosphates, that is something that we have to keep an eye on. I know that you guys are all about just kind of testing once a week, once every other week, just kind of seeing how the tank rolls. But I will tell you right now, if you have SPS in your tank and you're trying to get the optimum coloration or you're trying to get the optimum growth, testing multiple times a week is probably your best bet unless you have a really solid routine, a solid feeding schedule, and your food. You know, if you make your own food, you kind of can actually control the nitrates and phosphates levels within that food based on what you make it out of. So unless you've advanced to that point, I think you should be testing multiple times a week and adjusting and dosing accordingly. Now, with that, right off the bat, I can tell you if you have cyano in your tank and you think you have diatoms with the combination of zero nitrates and phosphates, 9 out of 10 times, it's not diatoms. It's going to be dyno. Now, there is a difference in look. A lot of people get them confused, and I know they're roughly the same color, but dyno will actually have more of a snotty, bubbly type of texture to it, similar to cyanobacteria, just more of a brown, darker color, opposed to the reddish, greenish color that you can get with cyanobacteria. Now, diatoms actually is one of those things that comes in as like a light dusting on the sand bed, on the rocks, but then will go away at night and come back when the light kicks back on. Dyno, granted, it will fade a little bit during blackout periods, but most of the time it's going to come back and it's going to be super snotty and pretty disgusting. Okay, so with that being said, let's go and talk about what you need to do to address this issue. Now, right off the bat, you have to get rid of the cyanobacteria. The cyanobacteria is just, it's one of those things that will consume the available phosphates in the water column. You could be feeding all day long, dosing all you want to get the levels up, but if you have cyanobacteria in your tank, it's going to continue to consume the available phosphates, in turn showing you a reading of zero phosphates, thinking that you're doing all this dosing and all this stuff and the levels aren't going up. But meanwhile, you might have an entire refugium or the side of your tank completely covered in cyano that's just actively consuming that stuff, right? So the first thing you want to do is address the cyanobacteria. Back in the day, I was a big component of just manual removal, extra flow, all that good stuff. Listen, I've gotten lazy and I have moved to certain things. And I'll tell you right now, ChemiClean is pretty awesome. It doesn't hurt any of the corals as long as you follow the directions with the UV sterilizer turned off, with the carbon turned off, with the skimmer turned off, all that kind of stuff, or at least having your skimmer overflow so you can get the oxygen, adding a bubble or, you know, air stone, all that kind of stuff. If you follow the directions, you're not going to have any issues using ChemiClean, and that stuff works, man. I mean, I always have it here on hand because I end up getting cyano every once in a while, and I just kind of do a treatment of ChemiClean, and then I just do my usual weekly water change. So with that, ChemiClean will get rid of the cyanobacteria, in turn allowing you to get the correct reading of phosphates in your water column. So first things first, address and remove the cyanobacteria with manual removal as well as ChemiClean, and you'll be good to go. Okay, let's go ahead and fast forward, and you have removed the cyanobacteria from the reef tank. It's time to test nitrates and phosphates. I recommend using the HANA checkers. Listen, I'm not going to play the game with the what colors what and what matches what. Just get yourself some HANA checkers, call it a day, spend the money, and you won't regret it, I promise. So you're testing your nitrates and phosphates. You're getting an accurate reading at this point. Now it's time to make the adjustments. Most likely, you are going to have low phosphates from the cyanobacteria consuming it. And once you remove the cyanobacteria, you're probably going to see that your phosphates are a little bit elevated. But it usually takes a combination of nitrates and phosphates both being low to near zero for dyno to kind of show its face. So with that, now that the cyanobacteria is gone, your phosphates are going to creep back up to their usual level, or at least higher than they were when you had the cyano. And you probably most likely will have to dose or increase some kind of feeding to get your nitrates up to help combat the dyno that's in your tank. Now, the reason why I say help combat or fight off the dyno is because dyno, I believe so heartedly, and listen, I'm not a rocket scientist or a marine biologist, but I can tell you that I truly believe that dyno is in our reef tanks. It just is. But I believe that it is kept at bay and kept in check by the beneficial bacteria that live within our water column. And with that, that beneficial bacteria that fights dyno survives off of adequate nitrate and phosphate levels. So when we bottom out our nitrates and phosphates, that bacteria that would normally keep dyno in check ends up dying off. And then the balance between good bacteria and dyno is then thrown off. And that's when dyno can kind of poke its head to the surface and start showing itself in your reef tank. So with that being said, more than half of the time, people are having dyno issues because their low nitrates and phosphates, the beneficial bacteria in the reef tank is not as strong as it should, and then dyno comes in and starts wreaking havoc all over the reef. So getting those levels back up to where they need to be, the system will bounce back over time. And this is another thing that I've realized is a lot of people think that, hey, my nitrates and phosphates are where they should be. The dyno's still here. What do I do? Well, it's not going to happen overnight. Just because those nitrous and phosphate levels are where they should be, it's still going to take time for that beneficial bacteria to keep up or to at least grow to get to the point where it can outcompete the dyno. But what you can do during that time is you can manually remove, you can, or the dyno, you can run UV sterilizer, and you can increase flow, you do different things, blow it off the rock structure, use filter socks, all that kind of stuff. And during that time, you can be dosing stuff like EcoBalance. You can, of course, keeping your nitrates and phosphates where they should be. And in time, that beneficial bacteria will come back and outcompete and destroy the dyno, or at least take care of it. And with that, I know this to be true because I've done it probably 500,000 times on my own reef tank. Sometimes when I get lazy and I'm not paying attention, I drop my levels, or I'm just kind of gone for a few days, or you know, out to left field doing other things. Dyno will start showing its head, and I'm like, oh, let me double check my nitrates and phosphates. And sure enough, one of them or both of them are at least really low. And then I make my dosing or feeding adjustments, and that stuff goes away in a couple weeks without me having to do anything else. I don't even have to do manual removal. It just goes away because the reef tank bounces back and the beneficial bacteria within the water column will take care of it. Now, when it comes to increasing your nitrates and phosphates, there are a couple different ways you can do this. I prefer to just dose it. I do have my Fish of Hex nitrates and phosphate supplement, which I sell on the website. I do dose that stuff consistently. Matter of fact, my 300 is being dosed with that stuff every single day. I mentioned that in a previous video. I'm considering adding phosphates, but right now with my current feeding schedule, I'm not having any phosphate issues. But having the continuous dose of nitrates on every single day has been pretty beneficial for me, especially with keeping the dyno and all that stuff at bay with the elevated levels. Now, you can choose to dose that stuff manually, or you can increase your feeding. Now, keep in mind, plant-based material foods are going to have more phosphates, so look for more meatier types of foods, and you'll get your nitrates from that. Now, understand that if you have, and this is just a side note, if you have algae, or how you guys say it overseas, algae, I don't know how you say it the right way, but either one of those ways, if you have that stuff in your reef tank, you have to get that out of there. This can be a whole separate video if you guys want, but manually removing and getting algae out of your tank, that's going to go a long way to helping you have the stable, consistent levels of nitrates and phosphates. Because again, just like cyanobacteria, algae is going to be actively consuming nitrates and phosphates to grow. Okay, now that our nitrates and phosphates are in an appropriate range, and for me, if you guys are wondering, I like to stay between 5 and 10 ppm of nitrates and 0.07 to 0.15 of phosphates. That's for a primarily SPS acropora tank, good polyp extension, growth, coloration, and I do have a little bit of LPS and soft corals in that tank, but again, primarily Acropora and SPS. Now, with that, I'm going to go over a few things that you can do next because you've already got rid of the cyanobacteria, your nitrates and phosphates are good. What you can do now is focus on manual removal of the dyno. With that, you do that through water changes. Now, just a heads up, if your levels are already really low, doing a water change is probably not a great idea. So once they're slightly elevated or they've been stable for a while, you can get away with doing a water change, maybe a smaller to medium-sized water change, maybe like a 5 to 10%, and just focus on siphoning out the cyano, the dyno in the reef tank. And I guess if you have any cyano left, you can go ahead and do that as well. But getting that stuff out and just kind of removing it all together will be helpful for the balance of bacteria within the reef. And on top of that, if you want to stop dosing anything other than nitrates, phosphates, calcium, alkalinity, magnesium, anything outside of that, you probably don't need to be adding to the reef tank. Now, I did mention EcoBalance in the past. I really like EcoBalance. It's extremely expensive for what it is, but I don't know. It could be one of those things that I think is doing something that might not be doing something, just like I think AcroPower is doing something and I can't really confirm that it is. It just, I don't know. I like the EcoBalance. I've been dosing for a long time and it seems to be helping. So with that, you can dose beneficial bacteria like that if you want as well. Okay, well, that's pretty much it when it comes to addressing this specific scenario with cyanobacteria / diatom / dyno with zero nitrates and zero phosphates. So hopefully this answers some questions and guides you guys in the right directions. Now, with that being said, if you guys want to support what I do here or you need some help or anything like that, check out my website. I do offer the one-on-one Skype. I do offer the dyno identification, nitrates, phosphates, coral, 3D printing, all sorts of stuff. You guys, I'm a one-man show over here, so I do appreciate all the support. And yeah, if you want to become a member, I still have the members. I forgot all about it. It's like $1. You can join to be a member and you can be added to my ending scrolling credits. I forget to mention that, but I should probably do that, right? Anyways, with that being said, I appreciate each and every one of you and I'll see you in the next video. Peace.